early course of the disease when there will be no airflow limitation even without treatment. But as the disease progresses or as the duration of the disease increases, it tends to behave like a irreversible obstruction if it has not been addressed properly. Diagnosis: in the absence of the gold standard test, the diagnosis is clinical, which means you have to rely on the history of classical symptoms of wheeze, breathlessness, cough, and chest tightness. They tend to be variable, seasonal, recurrent, or nocturnal. The presence of atopy, family history of asthma, or symptomatic worsening following exposure to the triggers, they support the diagnosis of asthma. Respiratory symptoms, the respiratory system examination may be normal during asymptomatic phase. Polyphonic wheeze is a characteristic feature during symptomatic phase. If a person has got a long-standing asthma, there may be features of hyperinflation on examination. During acute exacerbation of asthma, there will be tachycardia, tachypnea, use of accessory muscles of respiration. Presence of a silent chest or severe respiratory failure indicates a severe acute exacerbation or a life-threatening exacerbation. What's the role of spirometry to diagnose asthma? It is recommended that all patients who have got asthma should undergo a spirometry because it helps to confirm the diagnosis, assess the severity of airflow limitation, and monitor the asthma control. Does a spirometry tell you that a person is having asthma or not? No, it doesn't rule out asthma because during the asymptomatic phase, it may be normal. So what are the criteria to label it that a person is having obstruction is the ratio of FEV1 by FVC. FEV1 is the forced expiratory volume in the first second divided by the FVC is the total volume of forced volume capacity you can exhale during 6 seconds. If it is below lower limit of the normal, which is generally taken as a lower fifth percentile of the values for the reference population, then we label it as person is having obstruction. Supposingly the reference equation for a population is not available, then we use the fixed cutoff levels. For older subjects, the ratio of FEV1 to FVC is taken as less than 0.75, and for the younger individuals, the ratio is taken as less than 0.8. What is reversibility testing in asthma? The bronchodilator reversible response is defined as increase in the forced expiratory volume in first second by at least 12%, and which means it's not alone 12%, but it is addition. That is 12% plus there should be 200 ml compared to the baseline following inhalation of 400 micrograms of salbutamol or equivalent. Does presence of reversibility indicate that a person is having asthma? No. Reversibility can be there in so many other causes, in other so many diseases. If the spirometry is not available, can there are any ways which will tell you that a reversibility is present or not? Yes, you can take the help of a peak flow meter. If on a peak flow meter, the peak expiratory flow rate increases by 60 liters per minute from the baseline following an inhalation of 400 micrograms of salbutamol, then it is labeled as good bronchodilator reversibility response. So the presence of bronchodilator reversibility, as I told, is neither diagnostic for asthma nor its absence rules out asthma. If it is present, it's very good, you can label it as asthma. But if it is not there, it may be long-standing asthma. So what are the goals of management of stable asthma? They are to achieve and maintain the control of daytime as well as nighttime symptoms, to maintain normal activity levels including exercise, maintain normal or near normal lung functions, minimize adverse drug effects of asthma medication, and prevent exacerbation and mortality. So you control the symptoms, you control the lung functions, you minimize the adverse effects of the drugs, and you prevent the exacerbations and mortality. So what are the drugs which are available for the treatment of stable asthma? They include the relievers and the controllers. The relievers includes the bronchodilators. The controllers are the anti-inflammatory drugs. Relievers, they are quick to relieve the symptoms, while the controllers, they prevent the asthma attacks. The onset of action for the relievers is very quick, and for that of controllers, it is slower. The duration of action is shorter for the relievers, and it is long for the controllers. Relievers are also called the rescue medicines, and controllers are also called the regular medicine that you have to take on regular basis. So what are the actual medications among the controllers? They include the inhaled corticosteroids, which includes budesonide, fluticasone, beclomethasone, mometasone, and cyclosinide. Oral leukotriene antagonists like montelukast, zafirlukast, inhaled long-acting beta-2 agonists, salmeterol and formoterol, oral methyl xanthines like theophylline sustained release and doxophylline, inhaled long-acting antimuscarinics like tiotropium, monoclonal antibodies like omalizumab, and oral steroids. The reliever medications include the inhaled fast-acting beta-2 agonists like salbutamol, levosalbutamol, terbutaline, and formoterol, inhaled short-acting anticholinergics like ipratropium, and oral beta-2 agonists like salbutamol, terbutaline, and levosalbutamol. So what is the role of ICS in the management of stable asthma? ICS stands for inhaled corticosteroids. They are the cornerstone in the management of asthma. They suppress airway inflammation. Compared to placebo, they have significant improvement in the lung function, the symptom score, the quality of life, decrease exacerbation and need for reliever medication. Majority of the goals which we said in the management of chronic stable asthma are covered by inhaled corticosteroids. Are the available inhaled corticosteroids superior to other controller medications? Yes. Comparing ICS with LABA, LABA is long acting. The SOCUS trial showed that ICS monotherapy is superior to the LABA monotherapy, and the patients who are well controlled on ICS cannot be switched over to LABA monotherapy without losing a control. So obviously, inhaled corticosteroids are superior to LABA. ICS versus leukotriene receptor antagonists. Cochrane review concluded that ICS monotherapy is superior to leukotriene monotherapy in decreasing asthma exacerbation, daytime and nighttime symptoms, rescue medication use, improving quality of life and lung functions. Now, ICS versus other controllers, especially methyl xanthines, which are very popularly used in our Indian scenario. Lot of randomized controlled trials, they have shown that oral methyl xanthines are inferior to ICS monotherapy in managing chronic stable cases. What is the dose of inhaled corticosteroids in the management of chronic stable asthma? They have got a narrow therapeutic index, which means if you increase the dose of inhaled corticosteroids beyond certain limit, the beneficial effects, that is the anti-inflammatory actions, won't increase, but the side effects will go disproportionately high. The commonly used inhaled corticosteroids are beclomethasone, fluticasone, budesonide, mometasone, and cyclosinide. The low dose for beclomethasone and fluticasone is in the range of 100 to 250 micrograms, and medium doses between 250 to 500, and high doses more than 500 micrograms. Is any particular ICS preferred over the other? No. Though they differ in the pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamic aspect, such as potency, oral bioavailability, metabolism, and serum binding, the clinical efficacy of all ICS is equal in equipotent doses. This was shown by at least 3 Cochrane reviews. One is a regular use of inhaled corticosteroids, and second is symptomatic based use of corticosteroids. Till now, most of our guidelines, even the Indian guidelines for the management of asthma, used to recommend that for mild asthma or intermittent asthma, you use only SABA, that is short-acting beta-2 agonist. But now, in the latest GINA 2019 guidelines, they have advocated the use of ICS plus formoterol combination even as a SOS medication. This was based upon these observations. The BASALT study, the IMPACT study, and the BEST study revealed that use of symptom-based controller is not inferior to regular daily use of ICS, is as effective as daily use of ICS in as far as asthma control is concerned and decreasing the number of exacerbations is concerned. What are the adverse effects associated with inhaled corticosteroid? They can be local or they can be systemic. The local include the oral candidiasis, dysphonia. Less common include periorbital dermatitis, pharyngitis, reflex cough, sensation of thirst, tongue hypertrophy. Systemic includes The suppression of hypothalamic pituitary axis generally occurs with high dose of inhaled corticosteroids. In the dose of beclomethasone dipropionate, more than 1000 microgram per day. The risk of infections, risk of pneumonia, risk of tuberculosis is also related to high doses of ICS. There may be suppression of growth. There may be reduced bone mineral density, ocular side effects, especially glaucoma and cataract, thinning and bruising of the skin may occur. But at the conventional doses, that is at the low or medium doses, majority of these side effects are obviated. What are the factors which will influence the development of the local side effects and how they can be prevented? They include the proportion of the drug which is deposited in the oropharynx, the type of the drug used, whether it's a prodrug or active drug. Cyclosinide is a prodrug, while rest everything like beclomethasone or budesonide or fluticasone, they are active drugs. The frequency and the dose of administration of ICS. What are the measures to reduce the local side effects of ICS? They include use of the lowest possible dose and frequency, rinsing of the mouth and gargling of the oropharyngeal cavity after every ICS use, and use of a spacer device. To summarize, the use of inhaled corticosteroids in stable asthma, they are the controller medication of choice. All ICS are equally effective at equipotent doses. The clinical benefits are obtained at low to moderate doses. Start with a low to moderate dose and maintain at the lowest possible dose. Use spacers whenever using moderate to high dose steroids. Next is long acting beta 2 agonist in stable asthma. Two most commonly used long acting beta 2 agonists are salmeterol and formoterol. They are highly selective. They are potent beta 2 adrenergic receptor agonists. They cause smooth muscle relaxation for up to 12 hours. Formoterol, as compared to salmeterol, has a faster onset of action, has higher intrinsic receptor activity, and can be used as a reliever medication. The Cochrane meta-analysis of 62 studies involving more than 42,000 participants showed that LAPA are superior to placebo in improving lung function, symptom and quality of life score, and decreasing exacerbation. But the control of asthma symptoms doesn't mean that there is control of inflammation. There is masking effect with the use of LABA alone. Masking effect means that you have a control of airway symptoms, that your symptoms like cough, whistling sounds, breathlessness, they are under control, but the inflammation is not under check. This is associated with isolated use of LABA. The SMART study and the SNS study showed that salmeterol therapy either alone or in combination increased the risk of asthma-related deaths and life-threatening exacerbations compared to ICS alone. A Cochrane review on the risks of non-fatal serious adverse effects associated with LABA showed that out of salmeterol and formoterol, salmeterol has got more side effects as compared to formoterol and lowest with the combination of ICS LABA. So isolated LABA monotherapy, especially salmeterol, is strongly discouraged in patients who have got asthma. Is there any benefit of adding LABA to ICS monotherapy? Yes. The Optima and the FACET trials showed that there is a decrease in the risk of exacerbation and improved asthma control. Similar findings were shown by our GOAL study, which enrolled more than 3,000 patients. The SLIC study, the Cochrane analysis, showed that once we add LABA to ICS, there is reduction in the dose of ICS by around 50%. There is decreased risk of exacerbations requiring oral steroids by another 28%. And if you compare ICS with salmeterol versus ICS with formoterol, both are equally effective. Which is better, doubling the dose of ICS or adding LABA to ICS in uncontrolled asthma, or which is uncontrolled on low dose ICS? The answer is ICS LABA is better as compared to doubling the dose of ICS LABA. This was shown by a Cochrane meta-analysis of 48 studies involving 15,000 participants, which showed that addition of LABA to ICS is better as compared to increasing the dose of ICS in reducing the exacerbations requiring oral steroids and improved lung functions and asthma symptoms. Now, which is better, ICS LABA or ICS leukotrienes or ICS theophylline? Again, the answer is ICS LABA is superior as compared to ICS leukotriene or ICS theophylline. So, to conclude about the use of LABA in stable asthma, LABA monotherapy should not be used alone in management of stable asthma. Addition of LABA to ICS is preferred choice when symptoms are uncontrolled despite low dose of ICS monotherapy in moderate doses. Third is anti-leukotriene agents in stable asthma. The cysteine leukotrienes, leukotriene C4, leukotriene D4 and E4, they are the potent potent inflammatory drugs. They are produced by 5-lipoxygenase pathway. The actions are not blocked by corticosteroids. So the anti-inflammatory actions of anti-leukotriene agents are complementary to that of corticosteroids. The anti-leukotriene agents include the cysteine leukotriene receptor antagonist and 5-lipoxygenase inhibitors. The cysteine leukotriene 1 receptor antagonist includes montelukast, zafirlukast and pranlukast, and 5-lipoxygenase inhibitors include zilutron. What about the efficacy of leukotriene receptor antagonist in managing chronic stable asthma? Leukotriene receptor antagonist monotherapy versus ICS monotherapy in mild to moderate asthma. Leukotriene monotherapy is inferior. Standalone leukotriene receptor antagonists are more likely to result in acute exacerbations requiring corticosteroids. Leukotriene receptor antagonist versus LABA as an add-on therapy to ICS. A person is not controlled on ICS monotherapy, you add LABA or you add leukotriene receptor antagonist. Obviously, the combination of LABA with ICS is more superior as compared to adding a leukotriene receptor antagonist. This was shown by a Cochrane review involving more than 17 trials. Anti-leukotriene agents are well tolerated. Zilutron causes liver toxicity, which requires monitoring. Steroid withdrawal can unmask Jug-Strauss syndrome. It's not related to anti-leukotrienes. It's basically the withdrawal of the steroids which leads on to precipitation or manifestation of the Jug-Strauss. To summarize, leukotriene receptor antagonists in stable asthma, as a monotherapy, they are inferior to ICS. They are alternative to ICS in mild asthmatics who are not willing to take or they are not suitable for ICS use. As an add-on therapy, they are inferior to LABA. Antimuscarinic agents in stable asthma, meta-analysis of 6 trials using tiotropium showed it had a beneficial effect once it was uncontrolled with ICS and LABA therapy. Role of LAMA in stable asthma is as an add-on therapy in patients who are poorly controlled despite ICS LABA and those who have got asthma COPD overlap syndrome. Methylxanthines are commonly used in our part of the world because of its low cost and easy availability and ease of administration. The mechanism includes a bronchodilator effect and the anti-inflammatory actions. LABA monotherapy versus theophylline. The theophylline is inferior to LABA monotherapy. ICS monotherapy versus theophylline. Again, theophylline is inferior. And compared to ICS LABA versus ICS theophylline, again ICS LABA is better as compared to theophylline. So what are the reliever medications which are available? They include the short-acting beta-2 agonist, salmeterol and salbutamol and levosalbutamol. Rapidly acting includes formoterol, and short-acting antimuscarinic agents includes ipratropium and oxytropium. SABA, they are the agent of choice for rescue medication. Formoterol monotherapy as a reliever should be avoided because of the safety concerns. SAMA is less effective as compared to SABA. Oral beta-2 agonist can be used as a rescue medication. Now there is a concept of SIT or the smart therapy, which includes that you are giving a beta-2 agonist as well as ICS in a single inhaler. The Indian guidelines for the management of asthma, chronic stable asthma, says for step 1 management, you prefer a SABA on SOS basis. For step 2, you add low dose ICS or a leukotriene receptor antagonist. In step 3, you have to give a low dose ICS plus a LABA. Less preferred includes a medium dose ICS, low dose ICS plus a leukotriene receptor antagonist or a theophylline. Step 4 includes a medium to high dose ICS plus LABA. If symptoms persist, add on one or more of the following, that is tiotropium, leukotriene receptor antagonist, or methylxanthine. If it is still uncontrolled, you move on to step 5, which means giving oral corticosteroids or addition of omalizumab. Now, in the latest GINA guidelines 2019, there has been a holistic approach in the management of asthma, which means now you are not concerned alone with the drug delivery. You have to assess, adjust, and review the response. Assessment means that you confirm the diagnosis of asthma, you achieve a symptom control, address the modifiable risk factors, address the comorbidities, look at the inhaler technique, adherence, and the patient goals. Then comes adjust. You treat the modifiable risk factors and comorbidities, give the non-pharmacological strategies, education and skills are involvement, and then comes the asthma medications. Once you start asthma medication, you see the response that the symptoms are controlled, there are no exacerbation, there are no side effects, lung functions are maintained, and there is good patient satisfaction. In here, now the controllers and relievers have been divided into two, that is the preferred and non-preferred ones. There is a change in the step 1 and step 2 management, that among the preferred controllers, it is now the ICS formoterol combination instead of SABA SOS use. That is a sea change. That is, now you are recommending even addition of ICS at the very onset, not only to control but as a SOS medication also. Now, exacerbations of asthma are divided into three, that is the non-severe, severe, and life-threatening exacerbation. The severe exacerbations are characterized by inability to speak sentences, agitation, use of accessory muscles, respiratory rate more than 30, heart rate more than 110, pulses paradoxus more than 25, silent chest, PEFR less than 60, and PO2 less than 60 millimeters of mercury. Life-threatening asthma is characterized by alteration in mental status, orthopnea. On examination, there will be cyanosis, paradoxical breathing, a rise in PCO2 more than 40, and a heart rate less than 60, non-explained by other causes like pneumothorax. For patients who have a mild exacerbation, mild to moderate exacerbation, can be managed at a primary care level. All patients who have hypoxemia should be administered oxygen therapy. The targeted goal is to keep the saturation between 93% to 95%, except in pregnancy, where you try to keep saturation above 95%. High doses of oxygen therapy may lead on to deleterious effect and rise in PCO2. Lack of pulse oximeter or ABG doesn't preclude the administration of oxygen. If the oxygen requirement is more than 8 liters per minute, always monitor PCO2. SABA, they are the bronchodilator of choice for the management of acute attack. There is no role of parenteral beta-2 agonist or methylxanthines in managing acute exacerbations of asthma. As far as mode of delivery of inhaled bronchodilators is concerned, nebulized versus meter dose inhaler, both are equally effective. But if a person is not able to breathe or has altered sensorium, their nebulizers are preferred over MDIs. There are various approaches in giving nebulized bronchodilators, either a continuous or a intermittent use. Anticholinergics, especially ipratropium bromide, have an additive effect once they are added to patients who are on beta-2 agonist. All patients who have got mild to moderate exacerbation of asthma must receive oral or parenteral steroids. They have been shown to reduce relapse, hospitalization rate, and the use of SABA. Low dose of systemic steroids in the dose of 30 to 40 milligrams of prednisolone or equivalent is recommended for 5 to 7 days, and the tapering is generally not required. At a primary health care, once a person has presented to us with acute exacerbation, see whether it is really asthma, what are the risk factors associated with asthma-related deaths, or what is the severity of exacerbation. If it is life-threatening, which means the patient is drowsy, confused, or has a silent chest, transfer it to a facility where facilities are available for mechanical ventilation. If it's a non-severe or a less severe or a severe exacerbation, start patient on SABA, 4 to 10 puffs with a pressurized meter dose inhaler plus a spacer, or with a nebulization, and repeat after 20 minutes for 1 hour. That is, you give 3 doses. give prednisolone in the dose of 1 milligram per kg, administer oxygen and look the response at 1 hour. If the patient is improving, you continue. If the patient is deteriorating or is not improving, refer him to a facility where a person can be managed along with the invasive mechanical ventilation. Once there is an improvement in the symptoms, improvement in the PEFR, the saturation is more than 94%, and there is, and the resources are available at home, a discharge can be planned. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. If anybody is having queries regarding this topic,
sir, out of the total armamentarium of drugs in the management of bronchial asthma at different stages, do we have yet any role of injectable adrenaline?
No, sir. Except in anaphylaxis, in patients who have got acute severe asthma, I had to skip so many slides actually. There is no role of injectable adrenaline in patients with asthma unless and until there is an anaphylaxis reaction. Anaphylaxis means there is no previous history of asthma. A patient has presented to you, if he or she says that person had an exposure to some inhaled toxic fume or had an insect bite, where the differential diagnosis is not a certain, there you may give adrenaline. But in other cases, if it's a known case of bronchial asthma, there is an acute exacerbation, there is no role of inhaled or nebulized adrenaline.
Sir, any role of immunostimulants?
Immunosuppressants, they do not
immunostimulants.
Have immunostimulants. Patients who have got chronic stable asthma, immune stimulation has been used to achieve a better control. But as of now, none of the Cochrane reviews, none of the meta-analysis, they favor the use of immunostimulants in the management of asthma. There is one school of thought which says that it's already a immune hyper-responsiveness rather than immune suppressive state. There is exaggerated response. You can't use immunostimulants. They are called immunomodulators, which have been used. They have been used by Patel Chest Institution. We had never used even in PGI, but they do not have been shown to have a beneficial effect.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Now I would like to request Dr. H.P. Singh, MD Medicine, Medical Director, HOD Department of Non-Invasive Cardiology, Fortis Escorts Hospital, Amritsar. And the topic is lipid management, facts and controversies.
So good morning, everybody. And thank you, Vitul, for inviting me here. Vitul is an old friend, and we have studied together. And also, we are accident mates. We had a very serious accident together, but both of them saved. Meghna is laughing. So I'm here to speak about lipid management, the facts and the controversies. Now this topic was surrounded by a lot of controversies. Once we received a message on the WhatsApp, the cholesterol is finally officially out from the naughty list. So this is the one message in the WhatsApp which got so viral that all patients, they used to come to you, they'll discuss this message, they'll ask various questions, and even doctors got confused. This message was even being circulated into the doctors' groups that what is it, what is this happening? So is it a fake news or what? So this basically, in 2015, the guidelines came from American Agriculture Department, Food and Agriculture Department. And as we are advancing, we are gaining knowledge. So we came to know that eating high cholesterol diet does not increase blood cholesterol. So that was the message which was conveyed other way around. But it does not say that one should not concern, we should not be concerned about this high cholesterol level. Nor does it declare that there is no difference in the good cholesterol and the bad cholesterol. Nor does it say that high cholesterol does not cause heart disease. And nor does it say that you should stop taking statins. Now, as far as statins are concerned, again, there is one school of thought working that all this LDL hypothesis is a big drama and is all pharma-created scene. And that is why the drugs are selling like anything. The Lipitor in US is the biggest, economic sale, making bigger economic sale in US. So this is all pharma-generated thing. But as you all agree with me that we are medical students, so we do not learn medicine from Google or from these messages. So we learn medicine from books, from guidelines. So whatever the guidelines will say, we should follow that. So having said that, I'll say that CVD represents a considerable economic burden to the society, and this necessitates an effective approach for its prevention. Now, more than half of the reduction in the CV mortality in the last 3 decades was achieved by 3 population level changes in the CV risk factors. And what are those factors? One is the reduction in the cholesterol, second is the control of the blood pressure, and third is the cessation of the smoking. Also, one of the best way to live a longer life and better life is to reduce your likelihood of developing heart disease. Reduction in the cholesterol to 15 milligram per deciliter plus if you add 5 millimeter reduction in the blood pressure, you lower the CV risk up to 50%. And so most of the CV events can be prevented by prolonged exposure to low LDL levels and systolic blood pressure. So the whole scene of statins changed in 1994 when this landmark trial called 4S trial came. So in this trial, they used simvastatin to the conventional treatment of the coronary artery disease. And the results were so remarkable, so unprecedented, that it changed the whole scenario of the treatment of coronary artery disease. So what was that? This trial showed that there's all-cause mortality reduction by 30%. The coronary events or deaths were reduced by 42%. And the major adverse cardiovascular events were reduced by 34%. Then another cholesterol trialist, treatment trialist group in 2010, they gave us a rule of thumb. And that was, with each 39 milligram per deciliter reduction in the LDL from the baseline was associated with roughly 22% reduction in the MACE, regardless of the baseline LDL levels. So that is very important, you should understand that, regardless of the baseline LDL level. So that also implies that there was virtually no bottom limit for LDL lowering cholesterol. That was in 2010. So this is what we are seeing in 2019, the same thing is happening now. So this is the pyramid of the risk factors. So we are concentrating more on the primary prevention, like we have to prevent the risk factors like dyslipidemia, hypertension, diabetes, and then secondary prevention. But the baseline of the pyramid, which is the primordial preventions, we are not concentrating much on that. That starts from the childhood. If you want to treat the obesity or the high blood pressure or the dyslipidemia and the family history is there, you need to start everything from the childhood. And also the environmental factors and noise pollution is coming out to be a very big thing now, because we all are suffering from this. And this is one of the very important risk factors. Diet, again, you should concentrate from the childhood. Don't allow your children to eat whatever they want to eat and then land up with obesity, which you will never be controlled in your adult life. So these factors like diabetes, hypertension, dyslipidemia, and smoking, they cause endothelial dysfunction, inflammation, and oxidative stress, and collectively, then they cause the CV disease. This is an old slide showing different trials, both in the primary prevention and in the secondary prevention. They proved the LDL hypothesis. And what is that? That LDL lowering is associated with the reduction in the CHD events, both in the primary and the secondary trials. Although the effect in the secondary trial was much more than what we see in the primary prevention, which is demonstrated on this slide. Then in 2013, the American College of Cardiology and the American Heart Association combined together, they gave us guidelines on the lipid management, and they gave us four statin benefit groups, which means there are four groups where you have to give statins and they will be benefited. One was the secondary prevention. Secondary prevention is when the disease is already established. Either the patient has established coronary artery disease, has suffered from MI, or having coronary artery disease or peripheral artery disease or a stroke. So they are to be given statins. Second group was diabetes, age 40 to 75, and LDL is between 70 to 189. All these patients should be on statins. And third was the LDL level more than 190. This is basically the familial dyslipidemias. And all these patients should be on high fixed dose statin therapy to reduce the LDL level to 50 or more than 50 from the baseline. Primary prevention is the fourth group, where we have age group of 40 to 75. The LDL is same, 70 to 189. And the ASCVD risk is to be calculated in all patients when you are to start statins in primary prevention. ASCVD risk calculation is very simple. You have an app on your mobile phones, ASCVD Plus by American College of Cardiology. You have to fill few figures and it will give you the risk factor percentage. It will give you 10-year risk and then it will give you lifetime risk, both these risks. The different organizations, different associations are using different tools for evaluating the risk. There are some controversies also in that. Some people say that they underestimate, some people say they overestimate. But again, there are no Indian guidelines or for this risk estimation. So by and large, we all use ASCVD Plus app to calculate the risk. But in primary prevention, if you want to start the statins, you need to talk to the patient first. You need to tell him that, yes, this can be beneficial to you. What are the side effects? How this can help the patient? What are the harmful effects? Everything you need to discuss with the patient and then start the statin therapy. Then in 2018, the American College of Cardiology again, they gave us another guideline and they gave us 10 take-home messages. One was, in all individuals, before starting any medicine, you should concentrate on lifestyle. So aggressive lifestyle. And what was more important was, and they stated that we should all start from the younger age group, in younger individuals, 20 to 39, which we never used to think. We used to start everything when we used to above 40 or maybe 50 or when we suffer from coronary artery disease. So they stress that in younger age group, we should target this and we'll start with healthy lifestyle changes. The second message was, again, this is the secondary prevention. All patients who got ASCVD should be given statins. All patients who are a high risk of ASCVD, I'll come to later, little later, what is high risk. So all these patients, the target is around 70. And they should be on the high intensity statin therapy. And if with high intensity statin therapy, the goal is not achieved, you need to add non-statin therapies. The first in line is ezetimibe, the cholesterol absorption inhibitor, and the second is the latest PCSK9 inhibitors. These are the high risk groups. Then the fourth message was In patients with severe primary hyperdyslipidemia like LDL more than 190, again you have to give high intensity the lipid therapy, the LDL, the statins, and then again the target is around 100. If not achieved, ezetimibe, not achieved, the PCSK9. Fifth message, patients 40 to 75 years of age with diabetes, with LDL of around 70, start moderate intensity statin therapy without calculating the risk. That means almost all patients of diabetes should get this statin. So then you need to know the risk enhancing factors for diabetes. They are long duration of diabetes, albuminuria, reduced GFR, retinopathy, neuropathy. All these patients you can consider of jumping from moderate intensity to the high intensity statin therapy, again with the patient and clinician discussion. The sixth message, these are primary prevention now. So they are primary ASCVD prevention. Again, you need to discuss with the patient before starting the therapy. And seventh is, the primary prevention, and the risk now is to be calculated. If the risk is more than 7.5% ASCVD risk, then you have to start moderate intensity therapy. But again, you have to, risk enhancement factors should be studied. And what are the risk enhancement factors? They are all listed here. You can go through this, because the time is short, I will not go into the details. These are all risk enhancing factors. But what is more important now, what we are learning more is, that is not only the LDL, you need to go a little further. So now they have come up that apoprotein B is the risk enhancing factor. If it is more than 135, this is a risk enhancing factor. And then you can calculate the C-reactive proteins more than 2, and lipoprotein A more than 50. If it is there, then it's a risk enhancing factor, is a high risk patient. Then 9 is again the primary prevention without diabetes. LDL is around 70 to 189, and 10-year risk is from 7.5 to 20%. Again, decision depend upon the patient-clinician relationship, and then you need to discuss it. And if at all, if any case, the decision goes in against the starting of statin therapy, you should calculate the calcium score of the coronary arteries. And then if the calcium score is 0, you can stop statin. But if the calcium score is more than 100, then you will have to start statin therapy. And the 10th message was adherence to the and percentage reduction response to the LDL level should be adhered to. You have to stick to the medicine. So there are some then individuals left. They are statin benefit group. They do not come into the statin benefit group, like the patient with a less than 40 and more than 75, and the risk is less than 75. Again, you have to calculate these risk factors and then decide about the statin therapy. Now, latest 2019 ESC guidelines, there are some changes, but mostly the same. But the only thing is that more we are learning about this hypothesis, we are getting more aggressive. The lipid low goal is going down. So these are the various, how do we classify the patients into various groups, like the high risk group and the moderate risk group and the low risk group. These are the various major ASCVD risk factors. They are 5 in number: age more than 45, family history, smoking, high blood pressure and low LDL, and then other high risk features: diabetes, CKD, familial clostridiomycosis, then coronary calcium, non-stenotic carotid plaque and lipoprotein more than 50, and then non-conventional risk factors, again coronary score, intima medial thickness, lipoprotein levels and metabolic syndrome. And the combination of these, they give you the various groups: the very, very high risk group, moderate risk group and low risk group. So these are the these are the latest guidelines 2019 released just 15 days back. Now they have also classified, they have given their own classification again, but what they have stressed and added in this is this, that you can, even if the patient has got coronary CT coronary angiography done. Now CT coronary angiography is being promoted. They want, if the patient is diabetic or the high risk patient, they say if the patient is even asymptomatic, get the CT angiography done to risk stratify the patient. And if the coronary angiography shows stenosis of more than two vessels, 50% or more, then again they are classified into very high risk group. Although they are not suffering from any event yet, but still they are taken into a very high risk group. Then other groups are almost the same. But now there are Lipid Association of India also working very strong on this. And these are now 2019 guidelines. They are not, published yet. I think they are going to publish them in the CSI 2 months later. They have gone a little more further. They say the Indians are at very high risk. So they not only, stop at very high risk group, they have gone into extreme group. The red one shown here, these are the extreme risk groups. And they are again classified into extreme A and extreme B. Extreme B is basically a very high risk group. But in spite of getting to the goals of the LDL, the patient is getting repeated symptoms and the coronary events. So why they have classified into this? Because they have taken the LDL level to further low in these patients. So at the end, the American College and ACS, they gave us the comprehensive sort of thing. In secondary prevention, this is a flow chart that how you are to go about it. So in ASCVD, not at a very high risk group, then less aggressive treatment options than very high risk group. They are age related. Less than 75, you need to be a little more aggressive. More than 75, you need to be a little less aggressive. But then you have to give statin. But why I am saying so? Because there is again a controversy that maybe in elderly, the statins, they do not work. They have no benefit. No. This is now established that even in older age group, the statins work. And if you stop statins in the older age group, the coronary event rate increases or jumps. Then at a very high risk group, you need to be more aggressive. You need to, no age specific recommendations are there. So you need to think of azithromycin and PCSK9 in these patients. While in high risk patients, you may not think of PCSK9, but in a very high risk patient, you need to think of PCSK9. This is a primary prevention flow chart, little complex, but more or less the same which I have told in the initial 10 carry-home messages by the ACC and AHA. But what is more important is the risk-enhancing factors. These you need to know, because these can change the picture at all. These can change the picture totally. From primary prevention, where you think these patients, they do not need statins, but if the risk-enhancing factors are there, then you may have to add the statins to these patients. Now I'll come to the general practical things which we see in our day-to-day practice. The general question is whether we should do lipid profile fasting or non-fasting. This is a very common thing, but now I think the consensus is there that fasting and non-fasting hardly makes any difference. Only the affected part is the triglycerides. They jump from 18 to 36, but at the first visit to your clinic, you can take any sample. Maybe the next visit you can ask him to come fasting. And if the triglyceride levels are more than 400, then you can take a fasting sample and see whether to start the treatment or not. So fasting sample sometimes is required only when then non-fasting TG is more than 400. Then there are known hypertriglyceridemia follow-up patients, or patient is having pancreatitis and getting treatment, or you want to get some additional test which is to be done fasting, then you can get the lipid profile done. Otherwise, there is no consensus on, there is no hard and fast that you need to test it fasting. Now then, the other thing which I was discussing was, should we stick to the conventional lipid profile, or should we go beyond? So these are the recommendations of the American College of the European Society of Cardiology in 2016. So the class one was, you need to know the LDL, you need to know the HDL, you need to look at the triglycerides, and then you need to know the non-HDL level, which is now significance, because this calculates everything except the, this calculates even the triglyceride risk also in this. So after the LDL, the next target is non-HDL cholesterol. But the things are changing now. These are the latest guidelines. Now they have added ApoB also into the class 1 category. So the ApoB should also be tested in these patients. Now what is ApoB? Or what is non-HDL first? Non-HDL is, the cholesterol is basically a fat. It cannot move freely in the blood. So you need to be attached with the lipoproteins to carry to the tissues. So there are different lipoproteins present in the blood. Chylomicrons are almost triglycerides, mostly triglycerides. Then VLDL, IDL, LAPA, LPA small a and LDL, these are all lipoproteins and HDL. Now, what is non-HDL? As the name says, it is total cholesterol minus HDL. It is non-HDL. So this covers almost everything, right? So you just need to, nowadays, when you see the lipid report, mostly they have started writing non-HDL level as well. I'm done? Okay. So ApoB is basically an atherogenic substance which is attached to these lipid particles, and these are atherogenic things. But what is lipoprotein attached to the HDL? It is ApoA, so that is non-atherogenic. But ApoB is an atherogenic particle. But again, now a new hypothesis is coming. Is the LDL enough, or we need to take more things into consideration, like LDL particles? Like, this is a patient where in this patient, the LDL is same, 130 in both these patients. But in this patient, the LDL particles are just 2 and apoprotein is 2. But in this patient, the LDL particles are 4 and ApoB is also 4. So this patient with more particles is at more risk than this patient with the same LDL level. So we are going beyond the LDL now. So there are some recommendations for taking when we have to take the LPA levels. So LPA is to be tested in these patients. These are the guidelines they have been endorsed also by the Lipid Association of India. But now in 2019, what they want to say is that because the Indians are at a very high risk, and LPA should be tested in all patients once in the lifetime. Now, LPA is a genetically driven lipoprotein. It is not affected much with the diet or something like that. So 90% of the LPA is genetically driven. It does not change. Whether you test it in the childhood or you test it in anywhere in the adulthood, it will remain same. So you can calculate once in the lifetime, and if it is more than 50, it's a very high risk patient. So you need to treat the patient in a very high risk group. Then ApoB also, there are recommendations now, the ACCH recommendation, and LPA, Lipid Association of India, has also endorsed that ApoB is likely to be the greatest value in patients with pre-diabetics, diabetics, and metabolic syndrome. And especially when the serum triglyceride levels are more than 200, these patients should be tested for ApoB. So I'll skip few slides because the time is short, and I had prepared this topic because I was told that the Arun is not coming, so I was trying to cover that portion also. Then I have to skip few slides. Now the LDL goal, that is the thing which is very important, and this is what has changed from 2016 to 2019. Very high risk group, the goal was 70. Now 2019, the goal is 55. High risk group, the goal was 100. Now it is 70. In moderate risk, it is 150, now it is 100, and low risk group, it is 115, it is the same. So these are the latest guidelines, and the risk is, we are going down as far as levels is concerned. So this is again the same slide. So the concept now is from lower the better to lower and longer the better. So we start normally the statin therapy at the age of 40 or 50. So you don't know what is happening in the younger age group. So you need to take care of the patient in the younger age group, and longer the lipid level is kept at a lower level, better it is. So longer the better. Lipid Association, as I told you, the extreme high risk group, they have recommended that the LDL level should be 35 milligram. So they have gone down further in extreme high risk group. And this is a very important slide, the ADCI trial where PCSK9 was tested, and the acceptable range here was 15 to 25. Now doses, as you know everything about the moderate intensity, high intensity statin, but the only thing which I want to stress to you is that atorvastatin is not affected much with the renal function. So in patient of renal disorders, you can start with atorvastatin, which is a safe statin, than any other statin. Pharmacotherapy, we all know that we have to start with statins, depending upon the various high-risk groups, and then if the LDL level is not achieved, then you have to add ezetimibe. If it is not achieved, then you have to add PCSK9 inhibitors. So this is the flow chart. Now, big controversies, are the statins safe? We are giving so high risk, high intensity statins, are they safe? So most of the guidelines have said yes, they are safe. Although there are some side effects, but they are very minor, the benefit is much more than these side effects. So how do you approach with the statin muscle symptoms, which is very common side effect, and you need to calculate the CKMB, if CPK, if it is less than 4 times raised, you don't need to anything, you know, to do anything. If it is more than 4 times, then you can stop statins and then restart the statins once the symptoms have settled down. Then you have to restart the statin with low dose or with the different statin. New onset diabetes. Now this is a very important thing, and this is definitely there. This is definitely there. So it estimates that 250 patients for 4 years are on statins are needed to develop one case of diabetes mellitus. Risk is higher with more potent and higher dose of statins, that is more common in rosuvastatin than with atorvastatin. And risk is also higher in elderly. And absolute reduction in the risk of CVD is higher in higher risk patients, clearly outweighs the possible adverse effects of the small increase in the diabetes mellitus. So even if it is there, still you need to give statins to these patients. Effect on liver is safe. Now the recommendation is that you don't need to check the liver function test very often when the patient is on statin. Kidney, again, I have told you, neurocognitive functions is being discussed, that the patients, the older age group, that is why the question was in the older age group. But the consensus is that no, there is no such like thing. And this is the study which shows that no neurocognitive signals, even in the very low dose. And even the Odyssey trial, which tested PCSK9, although the duration of the trial was 2.5 to 3 years, but in this period, they did not find any adverse event of such types. But this is important, that there is no role of coenzyme Q10 in statin-related symptoms. No role of coenzyme Q10. And the creatine kinase and transaminase levels are not to be tested very routinely on statins. HDL I will skip, because nowadays HDL is not a very good thing, but it is coming up very fast. It is coming up in the sense that from the quantity, we are going to the quality of the HDL. So it is not the quantity, it is not the percent, it is 40 milligram or something like that, it is the quality of the HDL. So quality should be there. And these are the pleiotropic anti-atherogenic effects of the HDL. It acts through various mechanisms, and the various trials have shown that improving HDL level does not cause a decrease in the CVD outcome. Also, the American College has given that there is no limit, no target for HDL, but the HDL should be in women, in men it should be more than 48, in 48 in women and 40 in male. Triglyceridemia, very common thing in our practice. Now the question is whether we should treat it or not treat it, and treat it then with what medicine. So these are the lipid guidelines. Now the target given in 2019 is the triglyceride should be less than 100. One thing we should all understand, I'm skipping all these slides, that we should all understand that the triglyceride is definitely a risk factor. Definitely a risk factor. So it is definitely a risk factor for this, and we need to bring it down. Now, where are fibrates, the most commonly prescribed medicine in triglyceridemia treatment? The fibrates are almost nowhere now. And the most prescribed combination therapy is statins plus fibrates. So I think that we should avoid. And all statin-related symptoms, muscle symptoms, they are all increases. They all increase when you combine them with the fibrates. So this is nutshell about the fibrates. They increase creatinine level also, homocysteine level also, reduce GFR. So they are nowhere. So then what should be the treatment? So this is the trial, reduce it trial. Omega-3 fatty acid, this showed that if you add this to the treatment, this definitely decreases the triglyceride levels, and it has many mechanisms to control the CVD outcome. And this is now the recommended thing. These are the various trials going on: EPA, then strength trial, and then pemafibrate, another drug. These are the trials undergoing for this. And then the slide which I told you, from maximum tolerated dose to ezetimibe, PCSK9, and then now the omega 3 fatty acid, azino pentanoic acid. But let me add to this. When I say acetopentanoic acid or this does not mean fish oil. The fish oil capsules commercially available are not omega 3 fatty acids. They have got composition where the saturated fats are very high in that composition, very high. So it is not that. Don't take that. So it is particularly this which is going to affect us. So ezetimibe, I have told you, the Improve It trial was the major trial which showed that ezetimibe definitely causes reduction in the LDL level and decreases the CVD outcome and reaffirms the LDL hypothesis that low LDL prevents CV outcome. PCSK9, this is a protein which is there in the liver. And what does the PCSK9 does? So there is an LDL receptor, LDL particle here. This is an LDL receptor. So LDL particle gets tied to the receptor. It goes to the cells, and then it is released again into the circulation and becomes the LDL receptor. But if the PCSK9 is there, this is the PCSK9. This also gets attached to this complex. When it goes to the cell, then the receptor also is destroyed. So what happens is the receptors are not there. Receptors are not there, so LDL is not taken out of the circulation. So when you inhibit the PCSK9, the more of the receptors are available, more of the LDL is washed, and then you have decreased LDL. And definitely, this is a now proved thing. And EvoPAC is the latest trial published just 10 days back, 15 days back, where they have used this evalacumab in ACS patients, acute coronary patients in the intensive coronary care unit, and they have found that the LDL level goes down very fast with this. Orion trial, this is an inclisiran, is a medicine. Now, the mechanism of action is, it does not allow even PCSK9 to be formed. It's not an inhibitor, it does not allow PCSK9 to be formed. This is a next generation. And then this is the injection again, which is to be given twice yearly and very potent and getting very effective. So a heart failure, if there is no other indication for statin benefit, plain heart failure, especially in dilated cardiomyopathy, no role of statins. And in patients of aortic stenosis, again, some people say that it's a calcium and we should use statins. No role of statins in aortic stenosis. So primary prevention, calcium, I have already told. Now the next controversy is whether these statins are underprescribed or overprescribed. Yes, they are definitely underprescribed. We are not using statins in all these patients who really need it. And if we are using it, then we are not using it in a quantity, in a dose which exactly it should be done. Like this study tells us that mostly the patients are on moderate or low dose statins and not on high intensity statins. Even patients of ACS, they are not on high intensity statins. And also, it is our tendency, once the level is there, we try to decrease the statin therapy dose, which is not right. So you should stick to that dose and try to bring that LDL level if you want to give the real benefit to the patient. Can I take 5 minutes more or not? Then again, I'll take 2-3 minutes, okay. Then this is another controversy which says that high fat diet does not increase cholesterol. Yes, it is true. Now we have learned, many studies have come which have proved that it is not the cholesterol eating which is increasing the cholesterol requirement per day is around 9 to 950 milligram percent in our body. Every function needs the cholesterol levels, cholesterol. But cholesterol level requirement in our body is around 900 milligram percent. So it is produced by two things. One is the liver, and the second, what we eat. But it is so much, you see, balanced that if you eat more cholesterol, the liver production will be less. So the balance is maintained. But if you eat less cholesterol, then the liver will have to function more. So that is what the hypothesis which they have now come up. And they say, if you take cholesterol-rich diet even, it does not affect the blood cholesterol levels. It does not affect the cholesterol level. Then again, the caloric in and caloric hypothesis which we need to follow, that is almost not there. Even a high caloric diet can be a healthy diet. Egg is another controversy which they say egg should be taken or not to be taken because it's a very high rich source of cholesterol. One egg yolk is around 200 milligram cholesterol. So the recommendations, there are little doubt about this, more research is needed, but the recommendations are you can take one egg a day, even full one egg a day. If you want to take more, then add white egg, not the full egg. And in diabetics, maybe this is also very questionable, whether we should give this or not give this. So the recommendation is the carbohydrate in your diet should be around 40 to 50% of the total caloric requirement. And we are going down on the carbohydrate. Our diet mostly is carbohydrate. We need to go down on this. But again, there's a J-shaped curve on this. They say if you bring down the carbohydrate diet, even then the CVD risk increases. So you need to keep the balance around 40 to 50. Fats you should increase. But saturated, not the saturated fats, they should be less than 10% of the total. And even these are the diet recommendations. But even AHA, ACH, they say it should be around 5 to 6% of the total caloric requirement. Proteins you should also increase. So still there are controversies about the saturated fats, then wheat and the oil we should take. The unhealthy foods are listed here. The most, you see, important thing now is the insulin resistance. The big man is sitting here. I think he'll elaborate it more. But insulin resistance now is the culprit. Everything is happening around that. So you need to take less sugar, or maybe you should omit sugar. Sugar is the culprit. Cut down the sugar, refined sugar. Don't take that. Don't take the soft drinks which you take. One soft drink, 200 ml or 300 ml soft drink, it contains almost 25 to 30 teaspoonfuls of sugar. Never ever take that. Never ever. They are very harmful. So I think I'll stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Due to running a late in time, we are unable to discuss the